So I went back and forth. You know me. I went back and forth on what God would have me to share today if I needed to. I started a new sermon series 2 weeks ago talking about the fivefold framework that God implemented, that Christ implemented when he ascended back into heaven. He gave us a structure that we are to implement into the church to see the church grow and to see the church expand and to basically equip the church to do what he has called it to do. And so I was thinking, well, maybe I'll take a break from the series and preach a solo message here since we've got, you know, so many visitors and the team, you know, coming and make it more about that. And as I was really praying and building the sermon out, the ideas, you know, trying to just get on the same page with the Lord best I could, it kind of was like, well, it just kind of flows right along anyway, because here's going to be my premise for today, is that the framework, the method, the structure that Jesus Christ gave us to build the church is the same structure that we build whatever we're going to build. Everything applies straight across the board. If you're gonna be built into a phenomenal daddy, okay, a father, then you're gonna implement the exact same framework. I've been praying and studying and seeking on this for a long time. And this is what I've come to realize. If you're gonna be a phenomenal entrepreneur and you're gonna build a business that's gonna last, it's gonna impact, then you're going to need to be structured with the fivefold framework, okay? You say, well, how is an apostle, one gifted in apostolic gifting or a prophetic gifting, how does that apply to construction, or how does that apply to, you know, nursing or whatever it might be? See, it's the principles that are underneath each gifting. And I'm going to talk about that in just a second. So the fivefold, so just to kind of bring you up to speed, and this is not going to be super technical because I know you guys haven't been here, but the fivefold is that the text says in Ephesians chapter 4 that he gave some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, okay? Now that might sound like a foreign language to you if you haven't been sitting under teaching that has explained this, but I'm going to break it down as simple as I can. The message for today is some people are built different. Some people are just built different. Coach, you ever had somebody that's just been built different? Yeah. You look for those guys, you long for those guys. And I think if we talk about a sports and athletic team, baseball, football, if we say a phrase like, some people are just built different, what do we automatically think of? We think of some stud who's, you know, 6'5", 225 pounds of, you know, just ripped, and he's fast, he's agile, whatever. We think about an athlete that can really get things done, right? That's what kind of pops into our mind, is just built different. What I would suggest to you is that that's okay. I don't have a problem with that. You know, some people are just different in a physical way. They have a presence that won't quit. But what I'm talking about is, what I want to talk to you about today is that some people are built different in the way that they're wired, in the way that they think, in the way that they act, in the way that they feel, in the way that they respond to different stimuli in their life, whether it be positive or negative. Some people are just built different, okay? What I want to kind of maybe introduce or to bring you into this idea today is that you may be built a certain way, but you don't have to stay that way. Change and transformation is always possible. See, I believe that the Bible teaches that the world is subject oftentimes to generational curses. I've seen that myself in my own life, right? I have witnessed that in many people's lives. Now, you say, are you saying that children have to pay for the sins of their father? Not in the way that you think I may be saying it. I'm not saying that God is going to pour out his wrath on you because of what your parents did. No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that, and I believe that this goes into the supernatural realm as well, and I believe I've witnessed that firsthand as well, but let me keep it on the realm here. Sin has consequences, okay? Sin has consequences, and a lot of people think that all sins are completely equal, and in one sense, that's true. All sin leads to death, right? The wages of sin is death. So in some sense, they're on that equal playing ground. If you've broken one law, you've broken them all. But we know from Scripture that some sins have greater consequences than other sins. Paul teaches us, just for one example, Paul teaches us that every other sin is outside the body, but sexual sin is inside the body. It's committed against the Lord. It is joining the Holy Spirit with the spirit of prostitution or whoredom or whatever it might be. Sexual sin is on another level. That's not to say that sexual sin will get you a hotter fire in hell. I'm not necessarily saying that. What I'm saying is that sexual sin has greater consequences than other types of sins. That's just one example. Generational curses happen oftentimes in this way. Your mom, your dad, your grandparents, your great-grandparents, wherever it may have started, however it may have happened, they made a set of choices. And those choices impacted their life. And the impact that their sinful choices had on their life, the consequences of those run downhill to you. Let's take a very simple, very simplistic example of this. Your mom or your dad, they choose to put a lot of time, energy, and effort into alcohol and drugs. That's the choices that they make, okay? I would say the sinful choices that they make. And because they have invested their lives into drugs, alcohol, loose living, they have not invested their lives into training in some type of field of work or maybe getting a degree or becoming trained or getting insight and wisdom into this field or that field, just on a very practical level here. And so since they put all of their eggs in the basket of personal gratification of sinful desires and pleasures, they did not experience a training in a field. And that exposes them. That takes away a lot of influence, a lot of knowledge that they could have handed down. So since they don't have it to hand down, what they do have to hand down is what? Being well trained in the art of gratifying sinful desires and alcohol and drugs and whatever else. So you see how the consequences just run straight downhill. And so you have generational curses in the form of continuing to experience the consequences of my father's sin or my mother's sin because they were not a generational break. We'll see generational breaks, which I believe wholeheartedly only come through the resurrection power of the Lord Jesus Christ. You might see a shift, but you won't see a break without the power of the Holy Spirit transforming you from one domain to another. The Bible tells us this, if you've been saved, that you've been transferred from the domain of darkness into the kingdom of the beloved Son. You see, that's a transfer of location. That's just not a different set of habits. That's a transfer of reality. You are no longer sourced in this domain, but you're in another kingdom. Okay. So all of that to kind of set this up, how are you built and are you satisfied with the way you're built? You see how easily this relates to a football team. But it also relates this way in every area of life. Are you continually growing? Are you concerned about being a better builder? Are you concerned about being a better mom? Are you concerned about being a better singer? Are you concerned about being a better football player? Are you concerned about being a better student of the coach? Are you concerned about being a better coach? Are you concerned about being a better worker, a better employee, a better wife, a better husband? Are you continually pursuing greatness? Are you continually pursuing excellence in whatever you're doing, in whatever you're doing? What does the Bible say? In whatever you do, whether you eat or whether you drink, do it as if doing it unto the Lord, with excellence, pursuing after Him. That's my question today. Are you satisfied with where you are, or are you hungry for more? You see, some people are just built different. And if you're not built the way you'd like to be built, guess what? You can change that. I've talked to so many athletes, and I played football from the time I was in the third grade to the time I was in the 12th grade. And I loved every minute of it. And I told you I'd tell you a little bit more about why I appreciate and why I get so involved. One, you know, my kids have always been involved in football, so I try to be involved in my kids' lives, and so therefore I'm involved in football. But it's more than that. It really, really is. If it wasn't for the game of football, and some people think I make too much about sports, and to each his own, that's perfectly fine. I don't need you to love what I love. I need you to understand that God's placed a special passion and a call on my life that I can be influential and I can be used in some areas that maybe you can't be. And that's perfectly fine, because if you can't be and I can, then we can cover more ground. Amen? You see, in my life, I started hanging around with the wrong crowd really early. I was doing drugs by the time I was 11 years old. 11 years old, I'm doing drugs. And it continues and progressively gets worse. But the only people I hang around are people who, they do drugs and they do stuff like that too. By the time I'm 17 years old, I've got two DUIs. Every single friend that I was really close with, none of them graduated at that time. None of them graduated high school. None of them even graduated. I was the only one out of that group that graduated. You know the only difference? Football. If it wasn't for football and I had to be at practice, then I would have been right with them after school, getting high and doing whatever else that they were doing too, and I would have been gone. But you see, there, and Coach, what a way to set that up. Did you plan that? Coach Mike O'Shields, my coach in high school, did our devotional, the coach does a breakfast every Friday morning for the team. He'll have a speaker come in, and they'll speak, they'll motivate the kids, they'll give them a strong lesson, have some great guys come already. This past Friday was my high school football coach, Coach Mike O'Shields. And I think maybe some of the guys thought I was joking, but I said, I have oftentimes talked to Coach O'Shields. I still call him Coach. He'll forever be my coach, right? I've oftentimes called him, number one, to say, I am so sorry. That's the truth, God's honest truth. Number two, to say, you will never know the impact that you had on my life. Even though at that time, there's no way he would have known it, because I hated it. I remember one time, I've told this story before, Andy Youngblood was my JV coach. Mike O'Shields was my varsity coach. And one day, somebody saw me smoking cigarettes. Now, I was in the eighth grade, I think. So Andy Youngblood, and I would walk to practice, because we lived very close. I'd walk to practice, I'd walk home from practice. One day, I'm walking home from practice, and Coach, I can never forget it. Coach Youngblood pulls up in his little Chevy, 1980-something Chevy, and he's like, hey, Brandon, get in. I'm like, all right, give me a ride. Well, then he pulls down to the field and picks up Coach O'Shields. This is a single row bench seat truck. Coach O'Shields about to get in. He's like, slide over. I'm like, but they ain't nowhere to go unless I'm right in that. Okay. Shoulder to shoulder with Coach Youngblood, shoulder to shoulder with Coach Mike O'Shields. Hey, some of you will remember this. Twin Palmetto right now, it used to be Scats. Who remembers it? It used to be Scats. They pulled up into Scats parking lot. They didn't tell me at the field. I thought, well, maybe they're going to get something to eat. They're going to drop me off and go get something to eat. I'll be all right. They pulled up the hill. I'll never forget it. Go straight across, kind of up toward where Coach Thomas lives. Pulls in the parking lot, facing the field, puts the truck in park. Scats parking lot. I'm like, man, we getting a biscuit? No. I said, somebody told me you're smoking cigarettes. I ain't never smoked a cigarette, Coach. You know me? Nah, that wasn't me. And I mean, deny it till you die. I never did admit it. But you know, they talked to me in that car for probably 30, 45 minutes. They didn't cuss me out. They didn't slap me around. They were talking to me as a man talks to his son. And my dad wasn't around. Now, I didn't appreciate that. I thought, man, get out of my business. You know, get out of my business. You'll talk to me like that, I won't even come back to practice. Fast forward 10, 15 years, looking back on that, thinking, praise God. Praise God. I wish I would have done something with it sooner. Praise God when he places men and women of God in your life. See, right now, man, I know I was sitting right where you are. And I guarantee you, like, there's got to be at least one, two, or three of you sitting there going, I wish this guy would shut up. I smell that barbecue on the way in. But if you could just grab hold of a few things that I'm going to tell you, I promise you, I want you to know. Look, I've been on the field with you. I'm trying to develop. I want you to know. I'm going to look you dead in the eye, and I'm going to tell you as honest as I know how. the things I'm going to tell you here in just a minute, if you will implement them and ask the Holy Spirit to write them on your heart and you'll use them in your life, I guarantee you no one can hold you down. I don't care where you go or what you do, you will be successful in everything that you do. I promise you. Take that to the bank. I promise it. I promise you that. You want to be released to be great? Greatness is not in the form. Listen, some of you might go to play college football. Most of you won't. I'm just going to be honest. But every one of you can be great. Great. To leave a legacy that is not forgotten for 5, 10, 15, 20, 50, 100, all the way out through eternity. It's never forgotten. Echoes through time. Listen to the words that I'm going to tell you. Not because I'm wise or not because I'm a genius, but because the Lord told me this in His Word. And it's true. Some people are built different. I want you to think about it. Okay, so I broke this apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher down into an acronym, VOICE, okay? Now, we talked about this as a church, and we are laying this framework out as the church's voice, okay? But you can think of it as the believer's voice. Because here's what I'm going to tell you. If you want to be successful in life, and please don't hear me, let me go ahead and put some specifications on this. When I say successful, I don't necessarily mean houses, cars, money. That might be included in it. I don't know what God has planned, but that's not the definition of success. What I'm telling you is that the definition of success that I'm going to use is this, is that you'll be perfectly fine, filled up, full of joy, have mountains of peace, and be sturdy and stable in any circumstance that life might throw at you. And that's what Paul tells us. He says, I've learned the secret to living a full life, and that's to be content with the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, whether I've had a lot, I'm okay. I've had nothing, I'm okay. You see, to be a sturdy, steadfast, anchored, solid individual who's not tossed around by situations in life. Because here's the reality. You might be rich one day. You might be broke one day. Here's the question. Are you who you are even though the circumstances change on a dime? Because if you change with the circumstances, it means that you don't really know who you are. You're not steady in who you are. And the who you are is very weak. But a strong, sturdy, steadfast individual, even when the rains come and the winds blow and the floods rise and pounds on that house, it don't fall. Why? Because it's built on the rock of Jesus Christ. These five tools or these five standards in the framework that Christ gave for growth, progress, expansion, I'm going to lay them out like this. Number one, vision. Without a vision, the people perish. Now, I want you to think with me. I want you to broaden out your minds a little bit. Open up your minds. Is this applicable to the growth of the church? Absolutely it is. I mean, He gave them to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the church. But what I'm asking you to do is expand your mind out a little bit and watch the applications to every area of life. Because here's the news flash. You can be an awesome church leader and be a sorry father, which necessarily means you're not an awesome church leader. You're just a fake. You understand what I'm saying? You can be an amazing singer on the stage and just be ready for the preaching to be done because you can't really stand the Word of God. You just want people to see you singing. You're not a great singer. You're just a poser. You can be a phenomenal whatever, but if you don't have the Lord Jesus Christ in the center of your life, then you are not that well-rounded, sturdy oak tree of an individual. You're just using God to get what you would like to have. As Bodhi Bachman will say, if you can't say amen, say ouch. Right? Ouch. So here's the five. And vision, we're going to connect with apostolic gift. Oh, and let me just give a really quick side note. When I say apostle, he gave some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. When I say apostle, I am not talking about a New Testament apostle who speaks the word of God. Okay? That's the office of apostle. And when I say prophet, I am not talking about the prophet of old that speaks and they write it down because that's the word of God and every word comes true. No, that's not what he's meaning in Ephesians 4. We're talking about the apostolic gifting, the prophetic gifting, not the apostolic office or not the prophetic office, okay? These are lumped in with three more giftings, evangelism, teaching, and pastoring, okay? We're talking apostolic gifting, which is, so we would say apostle here. And think about it. An apostle is one who ventures into new territory. He plants churches. He starts new works. He's not afraid to jump in there when it's scary and everything's questioned. He's a visionary. He sees what he wants and he goes gets it. She sees where she's called to go. She's not scared to venture out into the wilderness and to fight the beast and to get out there and to start something new, right? You want something, you can see it, you go get it. You want to be fit, scared of the gym, you're going to go in there anyway. You don't know what you're doing, but you're going to look up online, you're going to find a workout, and you're going to put your hand to the weights, and you're going to work out. You want to go start a business, but you have no idea how to do it. You're going to watch YouTube videos until you're sick. You're going to look up and find the best ones that did that business and learn from them. You want to be a better leader? Then go read scripture, number one. Two, look at John Maxwell's stuff, 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. You say, do people really do that? Absolutely they do if they want to expand. I'm getting a little ahead of myself. Vision. Are you a visionary? Okay? Let me go here. I'll go through these one at a time. Visionary. Number one, if you're writing these down, write this down. Associated with apostolic gifting or vision, having vision. Be careful not to get trapped in the now. Now, look, I'm a big advocate of living your life right now. I've preached that from day one here, right? The church, I think the church wrongly preaches too often that Jesus Christ came, lived, died, was buried, resurrected, and ascended so that you would not go to hell. Well, that's true. Praise the Lord. I mean, I don't want to go to hell no more than anybody else. But listen to me. Not going to hell is not the end goal. That's a byproduct of the wonderful work that Christ did on behalf of sinners. The main goal is to transform you, to transfer you from the domain of darkness into the kingdom of the beloved Son. Not one day, but now. You see, Jesus says, Paul teaches us about what Jesus says. He says that we were dead in our trespasses and sins, but God has made us alive in Christ Jesus and seated us in the heavenly realms. You see, all those words are not talking about something that's going to happen one day. It's talking about a reality that's already present in the reality and work that Christ has done. In other words, if you want to live, don't hear the gospel as this. If you'll believe and put your trust in Jesus Christ, you'll get to live in heaven one day. Don't hear it as that. Is that true? Will you experience heaven with Christ always for eternity? Sure. And that's a wonderful truth. I'm not taking anything away from that. But what I'm telling you is it's bigger, better, and more awesome than that. Is that when you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you begin to live immediately. You begin to see what you could not see before. You remember what Paul taught us about the Spirit. It says the things of this world, they're common to this world, but the things of the Spirit, the people of the world, they can't understand them. It's foolishness to them. Why? Because spiritual things are spiritually discerned. You see, the people of the world who are not born again in Christ, they've not received the power of the Holy Spirit, they are limited in what they can see, what they can hear, what they can understand. Because it takes the Spirit to understand the things of the Spirit. What I'm telling you is on a whole nother level, guys. And you might think I'm crazy, but I'm telling you right now, you want to be the best football player possible, then you surrender your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You want to be the best dad possible? Surrendered life is where it's at. You want to be the best coach possible? Surrendered life is where it's at. You want to be the best mom? You want to be the best whatever? Because, you know why? It's because if you want to be the best human being, then you have to surrender to the one who made human beings and who knows how they best operate and who puts them back to where they need to be. So we need vision. See, be careful not to get trapped in the now. So many of us are trapped in the now. Raise your hand if you've ever been trapped in the now. and we can't see where we're going. We're not looking out, right? How much does this apply to every area of your life? Brother, when you first started your business, did you start one house and be like, all right, we got one, we don't need no more? No, we're looking out there. We're trying to figure out, okay, where am I going to get more business? How am I going to expand this thing? Where do I need to go? What do I need to do? Who do I need to talk to? Who do I need to learn from? You bring people in. You bring in resources. You learn. You study. You grow. You are big. Why? Because you have a vision. I know these coaches know all about that. They got a vision about where they wanted to go. Coach Bridges is brand new. He's trying to figure all this out. He's got 1 year under his belt. He started this season already. He's got a vision of where he wants to go, and he's got all these pieces that he's got to work with, right? And so he's got to start putting things in order. Not everybody agrees with that all the time, but he's got a vision, and he's got to go that direction. If he gets off that vision, or if he doesn't have a vision, then the people perish. That's the scripture, right? If he doesn't have a vision, then everybody's just going, whoa, over here, and you don't ever get to where you're going. Think about vision this way. Vision is clearly seeing where you need to go, putting one foot in front of the other, not taking your eyes off of it till you get there. Being trapped in the now is looking right here at what you have, which is, live right now. I'm not telling you not to live right now, but I'm telling you not to forget to look up to make sure you're on the right path. And the Word of God is a light into our path and a lamp to our feet. You see, we need the Word of God to know where we're going to go, right? That's where our vision comes from. Vision, we got to have vision. Be careful not to get trapped in the now. Develop a vision for the future. Some of you, Titus right here, he's a senior. Everybody in this room at times, we haven't thought a year ahead. We ain't even thought ahead to tomorrow or this afternoon. And I'll also say, be careful not to live all the way into the future, right? We got to be here present right now. But how many of you have thought what's going to happen 1 year from now? Put it on any level that you want to. What's your goal to reach so that you'll be better next year? Makai, what's your goal to reach next year so you'll be a better football player than you were this year? And you ain't got an answer, but what's your max right now in bench press? What's your max squat right now? Do you have a goal that you could reach, you could get a new PR by the end of next month, and you could take your squat up this X amount of pounds, whatever it might be? Can you get quicker? Can you shave some time off your 40? Have you thought about that? What can I do in the now to make me a better me in the future? Do you have a vision? Have you thought about where you're going and how you're going to get there? Have you written down a 5-year plan? Have you written down where you want to be in 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years? Keep note of how you get there, your progress along the way, right? Your progress along the way. Develop a vision for the future. This is all in Christ if it's going to happen rightly. Number two, this is... So first, you got to have vision. Second, and the coaches will appreciate this, you have to be objective. What does that mean? This is the prophetic gifting. To be objective is to be locked in on what your objective is, what it is that you're trying to accomplish. What is the goal? Where are we going? What are we seeking to accomplish? And how often, let me ask you this, guys, how often does something creep into your lives that has nothing to do with your objective for the day or for the hour, for that matter, or for the week or for the month or for whatever? Things just creep in, they pop in, they're not related to your objective whatsoever. And so what do? They rob time, they rob resources, and they rob you from what? From pressing on towards your vision. You see how these two are interconnected? You got to have a vision, and what's your vision set on? Your vision is set on the goal of reaching the objective. You've got to be objective. You've got to have a standard. You see, the prophet in the Old Testament held people to account that they were going to be sure, steadfast, and aligned with the Word of God. That was the object. The object was to fulfill the Word of God, to do what God had called us to do, to be faithful to His Word, to be steadfast and sure, to be aligned with His Word. And when someone got off, the prophet would call them back in. They were objective. They were not subjective. They did not bounce to and fro from every little thing. The prophets were objective even when it brought them death. They were objective. You have to be objective. In other words, to put it in layman's terms, be careful not to be a fake. Be careful not to be a fake. You see, we can think to ourselves, oh, I want to do this, I want to do that, I want to do this, I want to do that. And we're living one way and we're saying another thing. We're saying one thing, but we're doing another thing. We're not objective. You see, if you're objective, then you have one standard, okay? You have one standard. You have one anchor point. You have one. Here's the best way to say it. You are who you are, and that's who you are. And you're not veering. You're not swaying from that. You have your eyes on the objective. You have your eyes on the prize. You know what your standard is. You've read the blueprints, and you're not going to veer away from that. If you say you're a Christian, then put your money where your mouth is and act like a Christian. You can't say, I love Jesus Christ. You can't build this big aura and persona and then be hateful, mean, nasty, or cheating, lying. You can't build this whole thing out here and then come over here and live a completely different way. No, you have to hold yourself to a standard. You have to hold yourself to account. You have to be objective. Now, does that mean you never make mistakes? Well, of course not. We all make mistakes. But that means when you make mistakes, you see the mistakes. You feel convicted over the mistakes. You feel convicted that you wandered away from the vision and the objective that was going to get you to that vision. You see, if the vision is a sight of where you need to be going, the objective is the roadmap to get there. And when you veer off, you got to take a look at the standard. You got to get back on path. You got to get back on track, and you got to move that way. You know what happens when people have vision, but they're not objective? They have no standard. What happens is, number one, they get lost. Number two, they end up in the wrong location. Number three, nobody believes them, so they're walking alone. You see, it's hard to trust a fake. It's hard to trust someone who speaks out of both sides of their mouth. It's hard to follow a hypocrite. A lot of people trying to build a lot of things, but they're hypocrites, and so they can't figure out why people won't follow, why people won't buy in. Their vision may be solid, but their objectivity is in the toilet. And so people say, I'd love to go with you, but I'm not going that way. That makes sense? But a man, a woman, a young person who's solid, you can have your objectives right. Your character's solid. You're not two-faced, you're not a fake. And they'll follow you, even though you're headed toward the wrong vision. But you can have the right vision, they'll want to follow you, but they won't, because you're two-faced, you're fake, you're not real, you're not steady, you're not firm, you're not steadfast. You got to be both. You got to be both. Let me erase this so I can put this other up here. Remember your objective. You see, this word can be used two ways. We have to be objective, right? We have to be objective. We have to take and look at that. But we also have to remember our objective. Objective and vision are really tied together. We see our vision. The objective is to get to our vision. We can't get off track. And what is the standard, just by the way? What is the standard? It's God's word. That's the standard. That's whatever. You say, well, how can God's word be a standard for me to get to a state championship in football? How can God's word be a standard for me to grow my business? I'm telling you right now that the principles found in God's word are related to all life, because all life is ministry. The reason we can't see this, track with me. Is everybody tracking with me? Raise your hand up high if you can still hear my voice. The reason we can't see or understand this is because we have categorized Christianity into a box instead of understanding that it is the box in which all the other boxes belong. We have taken Christianity and we've pressed it down into this box that we put beside all the other boxes. That's foolish. It's foolishness. When you compress Christianity into a box that you put beside other boxes, then it's a place you visit from time to time, and it's not where you live. But when Christianity is where you live and every other box fits inside of Christianity, then Christianity informs every other thing that you do in your life. And what did the Bible say? Is that when we walk in the ways of God, we are successful in everything that we do. We're like a tree planted by streams of living water who bears its fruit in season, whose leaf does not wither. In everything he does, he prospers. That's Psalm 1, if you didn't know. Now, listen, I'm not health, wealth, and prosperity. If you know me, you know me. Again, I'm not telling you that if you live according to the Word of God, you'll have everything that your heart ever desired. I'm not telling you that you're going to be rich and have women hanging on both sides, right? That'd be a problem, right? It's a little inconsistent. What I'm telling you is that when you are planted and rooted in the Word of God and Christianity, Jesus Christ is the box in which your whole life belongs, that it doesn't matter what happens. It doesn't matter if you ever get married. It doesn't matter if you ever have $1 million. It doesn't matter if you ever have a fancy car. It doesn't matter if you do. Because you are rooted and grounded in love in Christ, and no matter what comes, you're a rock. You're a tree that never, ever perishes. It's there. It's an anchor. You hang a swing in that tree, and your grandkids are going to be swinging on that tree. How did I start this whole thing off? By saying what? That a lot of us are dealing with generational curses. Some of you are sinking in the mire of the pit that your daddy's daddy dug in his front yard. While some of you know what I'm talking about, generational breaks and those who have built a legacy because you're swinging on a swing hanging from a strong oak branch that your daddy planted, that your daddy's daddy planted, whatever it might be. Remember your objective. I need to move through this. I got a little video that I want to show everybody. It's not my video, but let me back up a little bit. Okay, vision, objective, influence. I'm going to speed up a little bit here. You got a vision. You've got your objectivity. You got your focus. You've got your standard. You're not going to waver from that. You see where you need to go. You know the direction you need to go to get there, and you're not going to let people draw you off one way or the other. You remember it every day. You think about it every day. You're always thinking, how can I get better? How can I be more sturdy? How can I be more steadfast? I'm not, you know, silly. I'm not playing games. I'm getting there. I'm doing life. We're still having fun. We're still living. Jesus says that I came that you might have joy and it be filled up to the fullest. So we're not talking, you know, rule follower all the time. No, we're talking about somebody who's actually free to live and live as one who is filled up full of Christ. Let's look at the influence part of it. Be careful not to be owned by posers. Remember what we talked about up here? Who are those who have a vision but lack objectivity and lack a standard? They're just posers. You see, they have this idea, they have this thing that they're talking about, going this direction, going that direction, but they're always going to the right, to the left, to the right, back to the right. Let me read this scripture to you right quick. I want to show you something that the Lord laid out, just pressed on my heart this morning. Listen to this, what the Bible says. This is in 1 Samuel chapter 15. Listen to what this word says. I'm sorry. This is Matthew 7, 21 and 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did I not prophesy in your name, cast out demons in your name, and do many mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you, depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. How is this related to this? What's the big idea in that text? You see, it's so easy to say the name of Jesus. It's so easy to utilize the name of Jesus to better our chances to get what we want. It's easy to utilize and use the name of Jesus when things are good and things are going your way and you want people to think a certain way of you. But it's harder when the screws of life turn and twist on you, when it gets rough, right? Or when the temptations of the flesh creep in and they whisper in the ear. Hey, man, you want to, then you're looking over there at Christianity, you're like, hey, won't you hang out here for a little bit, I'll be right back, right? It's so easy to do. Why? Because we want what we want. We don't always want what God wants, but God said, this is what I want for you, and I want you to want what I want, and the only way you're going to do that is to set your eyes on it, set the standard that I've already called you to, and don't let posers influence you. Don't be owned by posers. I talk to my boys about this all the time. Maybe not these exact words. I remember Titus and I were headed to first grade, kindergarten, second grade, every day on the way to school. Titus is 17 years old now. I look Titus in the eye and I say, listen, one day somebody's going to come up to you and they're going to try to get you to do what I've taught you not to do. You remember this? All the time. They're going to try to get you to, I said, they're going to try to convince you that I'm overbearing. They're going to try to convince you that you need to really live. They're going to try to convince you that your daddy's too strict. They're going to try to convince you to this and convince you of that. I'll tell you right now, you know and you heard from me that nobody in this world loves you like I do. Nobody in this world cares about you like I do. Nobody's going to lead you like I am. You don't listen to them. You tell them they're liars. You come back, talk to me. We're going to set you up so that you'll be successful in your life, so that you'll be able to leave a legacy too. You cannot be influenced by posers. Don't you let anybody take you off track. Don't you let anybody pull you to the right or to the left. You've got to be the influencer and not influenced. This is evangelism. You see, this is evangelism. This is what God is calling you to do. Let me relate this to the football field. It's all of life, guys, I'm telling you. Let me relate it to the football field. Let me use one of the coaches. I don't care who. You can just one of you can speak up. How much of a blessing is it? How awesome is it when you you see who your squad's going to be, you see who's signed up, you see who's joined a team, and you find out that there's a kid that you know of, or you learn pretty quickly that this kid is very coachable. He's got a great attitude. He hustles everywhere he goes. And not only that, but he is very vocal in encouraging, compelling, and calling the other guys out to, come on, man, let's get it. We got to get another rep. We got to be better. To calling and influencing other people to be coachable, to be on it, to be fiery. How awesome of a blessing is that? Everybody's looking for that. Everybody, in every way. Matt Fadula is a business owner. How amazing is it when you got an employee who's got a great attitude, great work ethic, he shows up every day on time. Not only that, but he's always encouraging the other ones or trying to show them how to do a better job. Is that not phenomenal? I'm a business owner. Man, those guys are hard to find. You know why? Because when you find that guy, he's usually his own business owner. Right? Right? You can't even pay that guy enough, right? Hey, and truth be told, those are probably the ones that are going to become coaches one day because they're influencers. But what I find is that, and I find it in the workplace, I find it in my own life trying to happen. I find it on the football field. I find it on baseball field. I find it everywhere. You go to the grocery store. There are going to be, you see, some people just built different. You're going to have people who are influenced, and you're going to have people who influence. What kind of person are you? What kind of person are you? I've got to know the team fairly well. I've got to know some who they say one thing, but I'll catch them out of the corner of my eye. They'll see me looking at them and go, my bad. Right? I still love you. I still love you. I'd love for you to grow. Be careful not to be owned by posers. You say, what do you mean owned by posers? What I'm saying is that a lot of you guys don't know who you are yet, and so you're shifted around, you're jerked around by the smallest little weakest poser who thinks he's got a great idea and he's trying to pull you off the path and get you to come over here and do this, and you know you shouldn't be doing it, but you get owned by him. I talk to my kids about this too sometimes. I say, you cannot be dominated and owned by the thoughts of other people about what you're doing and who you are. Because how many of us throw a shade over our Christianity just so we can hide it while we're at school? Because we don't want, you know, the influencers to know that we have this thing tagging along with us. Because we don't want them to influence other people to feel a certain way about us. Well, what if we walked up into school with a Christian strut? Not arrogantly. Maybe I shouldn't have said it that way. What I mean is that if you don't know it, you're born again by the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit lives in you. And when you walk into a place, God walks with you. When you stroll up into a room, the Holy Spirit just walked up in the room. Not arrogance, confidence. And when you walk into that room, you understand you don't care what those people think about you because they don't own you. They don't define you. Your identity is not in them. Your identity is in Christ. And if they were smart, they would come ask you, hey, what's going on? I need some of what you got. You see, evangelism is what? Spreading the good news of the gospel, influencing people with the truth and reality of Jesus Christ and who he is. You see, you want to be this. And when you are this, when Christianity is the box in which all of your boxes fit, then this informs every other area of your life. If there's something good, I want people to see it. If there's something right, I want people to know it. If there's something that will benefit them, I want people to experience it. Be an influencer, not influence. Be a force of influence. Look, guys, I know this is hard sometimes. I was in high school too. You see somebody doing something they shouldn't do. If you actually care about that guy, if you actually love that guy, if that's your teammate, then you ain't got to call. You ain't got to look down your nose at him, but you can say, man, is that a good idea? Come on, man. You know that's not going to help the team. Come on, man. Get your head out of the gutter. Whatever it is. And how much does that apply to our whole life? Right? You got a brother or sister. You got somebody who is getting into something that you know they shouldn't be in. I mean, come on. The most unloving thing you could do is turn a blind eye and say, well, I hope they overcome that. No. Love says, please, let's sit down and think about this. I'll walk with you. I'll go with you. I'll help you overcome. I'll help you. I'll walk the extra mile with you. You see, but we don't want to do that, do we? Because we're afraid. Be an influencer, not influence. Now, this is not talking about those who are good influences in your life. You have to also be a student. We'll get to that in just a second, though. Keep getting ahead of myself. Okay, right here. This one might be a little odd for you, at least to be in this grouping. Compassion. We can also say care. We could also say grace and a lot of other things. This is the pastoral gifting. You see, a lot of the times, let me put this up here. A lot of the times we forget about those who are struggling. A lot of the times we get elevated in who we think we are. We get elevated in our position of power. We get elevated in our influence. We get elevated in the place that we found ourselves, right? And most of the time, it's not anything to do with us if we are in this elevated state. It's where the Lord has saw fit to put us for now. But if we misuse that, if we abuse that, then it won't last long. Here's my question to you. When you're in this place of authority, when you're in this place of prominence, when you're in this place of success or whatever it might be, how do you treat the people around you? How do you treat the people who fall? How do you treat the people who are making mistakes? How do you treat the people who really elevated you, maybe was used to elevate you to the place that you are now? I'll give you a perfect example on the football field. Boy, Brody, Blake, Max, where am I? Max didn't come today. How in the world can I've missed the biggest guy in the whole room? Wouldn't it be nice if some of these lily white, soft princess running backs and quarterbacks and receivers, all these pretty guys, wouldn't it be nice if they come and say, man, thank you. You know, all of my success is dependent on you and your hard work. Right? That'd be nice, wouldn't it? A little acknowledgement, soft boys. You see, all jokes aside, the success of the running backs, the success of the receivers, the success of the quarterback, it really all starts with one guy. Raise your hand. We got two centers over here? Raise your hand up high. It literally starts with these guys. You can't run the ball if you never snaps you the ball, right? You can't run the ball if it's not blocking for you. You say, how's this? What in the world? Listen. You know how many people sacrificed for you to be where you are now?
Right.
And how quick we are. How quick we are to look at them as, what are you down there for? I was kneeling down here so you could step on my back to get up there. Christians are so notorious for shooting their wounded. It's not even funny. And we sometimes, watch how these are linked. Sometimes, you know, our vision, man, we're right on point. The objectivity, you know, we've got our standard. We're on it. We're running that way. The influence is on autopilot, and it's turned up to 100, and it's going really well. And we're going this way. We're going on this upward call, right? And we're going and going and going and going. And we forget that all of it was built on the backs of people around here. Primarily, all of your success in life is built on the back of one man. One God, man, Jesus Christ. Did you know that? Every breath that is taken by believers and unbelievers alike is all due to the work of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. Believers and unbelievers. Did you know that? The reality of common grace, which allows unbelievers who deserve to burn in hell forever to take their next breath. If you're an unbeliever and you're in this room, You might say, I don't even believe in Jesus. You had to take a breath that Jesus gave you to say, I don't even believe in Jesus. You see, Jesus Christ and the grace that was shared and shed on Calvary is the grace that is poured out on people who hate his guts and spit in his face. Bottom line is this, is that Jesus Christ was willing to let himself be killed brutally to pay for your sins so that you might be glorified. He was humiliated so that you would be exalted. Now we're exalted with Christ and through Christ. My point is this, is that to be a well-rounded, build a different type of way individual, we need every aspect. We need vision. We need a standard and a plan. We need to stick to it. We need to influence others so that they might get to experience the same blessing of vision that we're experiencing. Put it on any level that you want to, a team, a job, or whatever. And we need to make sure that we are slowing down and remembering the ones who helped us get there and remembering to help the ones with the blessings that we've received through all of this, helping others to get to the same place that may not pick it up as fast as we are, that may not be as efficient as we are. Remember, not everyone is where you are, and someone had to reach down to pick you up to help you up to get to where you are now. And the last one here is enlightenment or to enlighten. And this is the teacher. Oh, sorry. Be careful not to forget about the weak. Build armies with compassion. And I'm glad I remember to put that up there because this right here, listen, if you want to really build a team, if you want to really build a business, if you want to really build a family, I've made this mistake before, okay? So I've got the word on my side, but I've also got experience. In Ephesians there it says he gave some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Watch what it says. He gave the apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry for building up the body of Christ until we all attain the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God to mature manhood to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. You see, the whole idea is that there are some weak and there are some strong. There are some who are struggling and there are some who have got it more together. And we are to work together. The ones who are up pulling those who are down to this place up here. Working together, using the different giftings in order to draw each other in. And this is what I'm going to say to you. The best way to bring somebody into your fold so that the loyalty and the committedness would run as deep as humanly possible is to never forget those who are weak and to reach down in compassion, in love, in care, and to help them in their lowest time. Because here's what I'm going to tell you. If you're really good to people when they are really good helpers to you, and then you are really nasty to people when they are not providing for you, people will see that in a hurry and nobody trusts that. Because all it does is prove that you're self-serving, you're self-seeking, and that you aren't really concerned about them at all. You're really just concerned for yourself. They understand that you are using them and that you don't really love them. And so at the next day, they're out. Does that make sense? But when you stick with people when they are offering you nothing, they'll stick with you when they can actually offer you everything. If you only stick with people when they are a benefit to you, then it proves to them that you don't really love and care about them. When you are compassionate, when you go the extra mile, and man, this is speaking to me, because compassion is one of the areas where I struggle the most. When you really love people in their lowest point, they'll stay with you when they get to their highest point, and they don't really need you anymore in that way. Does that make sense? 5, be careful not to be stupid. It's a thing. 5th one here is enlighten. I'd say this, seek that which can enlighten. And yeah, you know, all jokes aside, be careful not to be stupid. Here's what I would say. Be careful not to be comfortable not learning anything. Be careful not to get complacent with what you know and think that, well, I know everything I need to know. Listen, you should be hungry for knowledge. You should be hungry for wisdom. You should get after it. If you want to be a better lineman, you should be watching all. You should be watching Aaron Donald. You should be watching Reggie White videos. You should be watching the latest and greatest. You should be watching coaches who do drills. You should be learning drills. You could put drills up in your backyard. You can get better. The only reason, and listen, this is football, but if you want to be a better contractor, there's ways. If you want to be a better Christian, surely there's ways. If you want to be a better fill in the blank, all you've got to do is to pursue after. The Bible tells us that he who seeks wisdom is wise. If you want to become greater at whatever it is, all you have to do is put the time in, the energy in, and seek after it. Seek after enlightenment. If you want to be a better fill in the blank, then find someone who's better at that and spend time with them. Ask them questions. I'll never forget, one of the greatest things that ever happened to my business, this is probably 15 years ago, is I was trying to figure some things out. I'd never run a business before. I was real eager and I was willing to work, but I didn't really know. And so what I did was I called up Eric Snyder. He owns Snyder Tree Care and a $1 million business. And I had a pickup truck and a couple of little chainsaws. And I asked Eric, I was like, hey, could we have lunch one day? I just want to pick your brain. And I figured he'd just say, you know, I ain't got time for you. Who are you? But, you know, amazingly, he said, yeah, sure. So I said, all right, I'll buy lunch with the $20 I've got to my name. Yeah. So we did. We went out and met at out here at 14 at one of the restaurants out here. Well, we met a few times. I don't know where we met that time. But anyway, we had lunch, and he just laid out wisdom. Laid out wisdom. And I was just soaking it up like a sponge. One of the things that he told me I couldn't believe, because at that point, you know, I didn't know a whole lot, but I had thought that in order to build a successful business, I got to be the cheapest one so that people will hire me. You know what Eric Snyder said? That's no joke. He's told me, he said, Brandon, he said, you're thinking all wrong. He said, I want to be the highest one. That's what he told me. That didn't make no sense to me. I said, the highest one. I asked him, I was like, what? How do you get jobs? He said, people will pay the highest prices if you have the best service. And he said, and it cuts out all of the people that I don't really want to deal with anyway. They're going to negotiate me until I'm, you know, they're going to spend 2 hours negotiating with me over $5. He said, let other people have those customers. Now, I didn't fully adopt that. I don't want to be the highest, but I don't want to be the cheapest either. I don't want to be the cheapest either. Wisdom. Do you even listen to your coach? Did I listen to my coach? Do you listen to your coach? I saw Coach Thompson talking to one of the linemen on the field the other day, or he talking to players all the time. He said, teach them a little technique. Listen, when you come outside, you got to stay outside and you got to contain. Don't get sucked in. You know, this is your job. Are they listening? Are you listening when you get that? Why is he saying that? He's not saying that to hear himself talk. You know, I coach Little League, coach the sixth graders. And I try, one of my biggest tasks is convince them that I'm not just talking. Like, if you'll do this, I promise you, you'll be at least a little better. Right? If you'll just do this, you'll be a little bit better. But they're like, hurry, hurry. Forget everything I just said. Right? You got to repetition over and over and over. But they come to the next practice. So praise the Lord, right? You get to work with them again. Work with them again. Work with them again. And if you're very consistent, you pour it out, and they can soak it up, and they get better and better and better. But I guarantee, I've had coaches. I've been coaching Little League for a long time now. And you guys all have been coaching probably longer than me. And you, all of you who have children, you know this fact too, right? You are going to have some that are just not coachable. It does not matter how passionate you are. It does not matter how much you love them. It does not matter how much compassion you have for them. It does not matter. You could have hung the moon, and either they don't care to know, they don't want to know, or they just are not picking up what you're putting down and don't know that they can. They're just not built for that. But we pour and we pour. So don't be the uncoachable one. Don't be stupid. And when I say stupid, I'm not mean as stupid as a lack of knowledge. I mean stupid as a lack of the understanding that knowledge is available and the desire to go get it. Go get it. You can. The sky's the limit. Seek that which can enlighten. So when you put all these things together, it's really just maturity. It's just really maturity. And you heard the verse I just read. This, when we get all these things, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, when we understand that we have a vision, when we understand what that vision is, and that vision might change, it might shift. That's okay. The more you grow, the more you understand, you dial that vision in. But we've got to have a standard. We got to have the play. You guys got a playbook, right? You guys have a coach. How many of you have heard that? If you haven't heard this, you need to go listen to it. Tim Tebow was giving a speech, I don't know if it's necessarily a sermon, but he was talking about the Word of God, and what he was talking about is you can know the playbook really well, but if you understand the playbook to be an end in and of itself, you've missed the whole point. That reading and understanding of the playbook is really just getting into the head of the coach. Reading and understanding the playbook is really just the way that you get to know and feel the heart of the coach. And he related that back to the Word of God. You know, the Bible says that demons believe and they shudder. They understand. You see, Satan is a much better theologian than you and I will ever be. He knows. He knows all about what the Bible says. That's not the problem. The problem is knowing him. Remember what I read in Matthew chapter 7. You can do all of this Christian stuff. You can take the name of Christ. You can go to church. You can do all of this. But if you don't know him, then you know the playbook, but you're not a part of the team. You know the playbook, but you hadn't bought in, right? You hadn't bought into the vision of the coach. You hadn't bought in and set that playbook and set his desires as your objective to meet those desires. You hadn't bought in so much that you're trying to convince everybody else to buy in. You're not being an influencer. You're letting them influence you to skip practice. You're letting them influence you to skip church. You're letting them influence you in skipping the things of God. You see, you don't have compassion is because you're not bought in. You see, if you've got compassion, if you're really bought in, then when somebody falls by the wayside, you're so committed to the vision. You're so on course. You're so committed to it, and you have this desire that won't quit influencing. When somebody falls down, you're going to stop and take the time to pick them up because you're so given to the vision that you know more people need to come with you to the vision. So it causes you to stop and pick them up and say, look, man, don't give up. You got a teammate about to quit. Just a little related here. You got a teammate that's about to quit. He's about to step out. He's giving up. You know, coach going to talk to me like that. You know, listen, you go to that guy and you're about, look, man, don't get knocked off course because of this. You know what we're trying to do here. You know we're trying to get better. You know we're trying to have a winning season. You know what we're trying to do. You know what we're trying to do. Come on, man. You got to get your head right. If the coach made a mistake, or if that guy made a mistake, or if this guy made a mistake, forget about that, man. You know, that doesn't have anything to do with the objective. That doesn't have anything to do with the vision. Let's stay the course. Come on, man, let's go. You see, the influence and compassion go hand in hand. And we're all continually seeking to pursue, to understand more what the coaches want, what the desires are, learn each other, learn our own jobs better, do our jobs, support each other. This is all of life. All of life. I want to honor the team for a minute. I've got a video. Well, I just pulled the video, the highlight videos for the last two games that these guys have been in. They have been on fire. And let me say this, guys. I'm proud of you. I'm proud of the men that you're becoming. I love to watch you play. I love the aggression. I love the intensity. You guys are doing an awesome job. Let me say this. If you will focus on your life with Christ, and if you will surrender your life with Christ, and you will go home and write these things down, see where you fall into every one of these categories. If you will surrender your life to Christ, then your whole life will transform. And this is just, we can apply this to football. It can be applied anywhere. I would love to see you men be absolutely successful in every realm of life, to be the best fathers, to be the best business owners or employees, or to be the best whatever, students, you go off to college, whatever it might be. I want to see you guys flourish. I wouldn't lie to you. I promise you, Christ is where it's at, and implementing his teachings and a love for him into every area of your life. If you don't know Christ, surrender your life today. It's what's going to transform you, I promise. I could not say it any more clearly than that. Go ahead and roll that.
Okay, y'all ready for a lecture? Talk about the importance of nothing. You get up every day, you're entitled to nothing. Nobody owes you nothing. You could have talent, but if you don't have discipline and you don't execute, you don't focus, what do you get? Nothing. If you're complacent and not paying attention to detail, what does that get you? Nothing. Nothing is acceptable but your best. Everything is determined by what you do and you trying to be your best so that you can build on positive performance. And that's the only thing. There should be nothing else.
Press the play, guys. I think the score from the last game was 56 to, what was the? 56-24, and then the game before that was 46-6, something like that. Anyway, these guys have been playing their hearts out. Lost the first game of the season, shouldn't have, but getting some things dialed in. But these guys are doing great. Not only on the field, but also off the field, too. I've been impressed with a lot of these guys, but continue to pray. And boys, I'm just – to say it just as from my heart as I can, I hope you have all the success in the world on the football field. I hope you win every game the rest of the season. I hope you blow everybody out and they wish they'd have never met you. But what I long for more than anything is that I'd rather see you lose to every game the rest of the season, but understand the worth and the value of the Lord Jesus Christ. But what I'd love is to have both. Surrender your life to Christ, not in a way that, man, well, you know, we do these things, you know, we pray a prayer, we do all that, you know, that's cool, whatever. But I'm asking you, do you live your life for Christ every day? Do you see where he's calling you to go? Do you have that vision? Do you understand that the Word of God is our standard? It's our objective. Living our lives for him, glorifying him, that's what we're doing. That's the standard. That's the plan. You know, How in love with him are you? How committed, how loyal are you to Christ? How excited? I was thinking about this last night. I think evangelism and the sharing of the gospel, the sharing of our testimony, to let somebody know what Jesus has done with us, I think it's one of the most clear markers of Christianity. Because, I mean, come on, we eat a good meal somewhere and we got to tell somebody about it. If we really believe that Christ is King and that he made a way for us to live with him for eternity in heaven, he made a way for us to become alive right now and to live the fullest life that you could possibly imagine right now, how can we not tell somebody about that? I hope you're sharing, and not just sharing in that way, but just loving on people, bringing people with you, helping people to see. I pray that you're compassionate with one another. I pray that you're compassionate with your family, your parents. I know they make mistakes. I pray that they're compassionate with you. I pray that you understand all these things, that the Holy Spirit might take you to a place that you couldn't even imagine you have gone. Don't settle for where you are now. Always be pursuing after that which is greater. His name is Jesus Christ. If you don't know him, surrender today. If you do know him, be so thankful and get after him and get to know him even better. Let's all stand to our feet. We're going to have one song to close it out. If the Lord has pressed on your heart today, anybody in this room, if the Lord has pressed on your heart, maybe he's convicted you of things that stand in the way of you being great in the name of Christ, maybe something that is out of line in your life, maybe you've not been consistent in the way that you walk, surrender your life today. Coach, player, congregant, business owner, teacher, student, doesn't matter. If you've not given your life, surrender. If you have given your life and you're not being consistent, surrender.